to go straight to the message and promote a kids' talk this week. O Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts be pleasing and acceptable to you, our rock and our redeemer. Amen.
Amen.
On hearing Jesus' words, many of his disciples said, "This is a hard teaching. Who can accept it?" Who here can identify with that? You know, sometimes it can be easier for us to identify with the crowds who doubt Jesus here than with the apostles themselves who stood by Jesus. I mean, these are hard words, Jesus says. And look what Jesus has been saying here throughout John chapter 6 over the last couple of weeks. He tells us that he is the bread of life, that he provides the only food that truly nourishes, and that this food is his very self, his own flesh and his blood, and that if we feast on him, we can have forgiveness of sins, abundant life here now, and eternal life in heaven. These can be hard words. These can be hard words to hear, hard to understand, hard to believe. So it's no wonder then that we see in verse 66 that many turned back and no longer followed him. Now it's tempting to write these people off as being too lazy or too fickle or too faithless to believe. But notice in verse 66 that John calls these people not simply the crowds, but rather his disciples. Many of Jesus' own disciples turned back and no longer followed him. What a sad and sober thought, because we're meant to see ourselves in this verse. The very people in this gospel reading who walk away from Jesus are the very same ones who once believed in Jesus, just like we do. They once gave up everything to follow Jesus, to be his disciples. But now after all they're watching, all they're waiting, all they're wondering, they've grown tired of Jesus. And now they can no longer see what it was that attracted Jesus to them in the first place. And they walk off. They leave their faith. But before we're too quick to judge them, we're meant to ask ourselves, are we really all that different from them? I mean, which of us has not at one time doubted and wondered whether or not we may have trusted in Jesus in vain? Maybe it's during the dark of the night when we wonder, and when you're praying by the bedside of a child or a grandchild or a spouse, and you're wondering, why are they so sick? Are they ever going to get better? And will my prayers really matter? Maybe it's in the early of the morning when you wake up and you wonder, why I still can't find work? And you're worried about whether you ever will find a job again. And you wonder, does Jesus even care? Or maybe it's later in the day and you're thinking about your family. There's so much hostility, so much anger, so much hurtful words spoken against one another. You wonder why things have turned out this way and why other families seem so much more normal and happy. And you wonder, where's Jesus? And if we're honest with ourselves, those moments of doubt come to us far more often than we care to admit. And at those times, just like these disciples in today's gospel reading, sometimes we too may be tempted to conclude that our faith in Jesus has failed us, and that life, true abundant life, must be found somewhere else. Or maybe as good Lutherans, we wouldn't actually say that out loud. We wouldn't be so brash as to publicly renounce Jesus, but we have more subtle, passive-aggressive ways of walking away from Jesus as Lutherans, don't we? Maybe we just don't make that extra effort to come to church so regularly anymore. You know, take a little vacation from God. You know, you can have church at home. We never do, but you say that. Then our prayer life at home begins to diminish. Maybe we only pray after meals or before meals, and then even that starts to decline after a while. Maybe we don't read our Bibles regularly so much anymore. Maybe we start to reduce our offerings to the church because other things start to become more important to us. Or maybe we're finding ourselves now too busy to help others, or too busy even to see other people from the church. And this gradual, subtle walking away from Jesus continues until we end up just like these disciples here in verse 66, who turned back and no longer followed Jesus. So while I think this picture that John paints for us in today's reading is not a very pretty one, I think it's a very realistic one. Because sometimes the life of faith can seem too hard for us. But that's not the end of the story, is it? That's not the end of the story that John paints for us here, because John also paints another picture for us. Another picture that is full of faith, courage, and hope. Look at verses 66 to 69. From this time, many of his disciples turned back and no longer followed him. You do not want to leave too, do you? Jesus asked the 12. But Simon Peter answered him, Lord, to whom shall we go? Let's read that together from verse 68. Verse 68. Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. We have come to believe and to know that you are the Holy One of God. What made Peter and the apostles so different from the other disciples that day who walked away from Jesus? What made them so different? What made them stand out? Were they smarter than those other people? Were they more humble than those other people? Were they more courageous? Were they better people? Were they some kind of spiritual giants? No, not at all. Only one thing set the apostles apart from those other disciples that day. And it's the same thing that sets you apart today. Again, look at verse 68. Simon Peter answered him, Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. And that is what set the apostles apart that day. That is what sets you apart by the simple fact that you're here today. They knew where to look to find life, just as you do. The apostles weren't smarter people, they weren't better people, they just knew where to look. They knew that no matter how hard Jesus' words sounded, no matter how impossible his promises seemed, no matter how helpless they felt as they prayed in the darkness of the night, they knew to keep looking to Jesus, to keep their eyes fixed on Jesus. Because where else are we going to go, Peter asks. You alone, Jesus, have the words of eternal life. They just knew where to look. And that is why for the past 2,000 years, the life of the church has proven itself to be so important, so vital to Christians all across the world. It is each and every week, through the preaching of the word, through the giving of the sacrament, you and I are offered once again the words of eternal life. We're offered Jesus himself. In the midst of all our disappointments and hurts and anxieties in our daily life, here the word and the sacrament are pointed to the one true place where Jesus can be found, where life can be found. Jesus, who alone is the bread of life. Now this is not to say we can't find God at work elsewhere in the world. Of course we can. Through the eyes of faith, we can see God in nature. We can see God in the work that we do at the office or at home. We can see God in the face of a child. But because we live in a fallen world, sometimes it can be hard to see God in these places. Sometimes nature turns violent. Sometimes work becomes a place of stress and turmoil. Sometimes that child makes bad choices with their life and goes astray. Then it becomes really hard to find God in those places. And when all these things that we usually count on fail us and turn out empty, where do we turn? It's at these times we hear the church calling us back again. So we can see Jesus. So we can hear Jesus once again offering himself to you and to me through the preaching of the word, through the giving of the sacrament, offering you once again the promise of forgiveness, acceptance, meaning, and life. One of Martin Luther's sermons, he once wrote this. Luther wrote, God is present everywhere. He's present in all his creatures. I might even find him in stone, or in fire, in water, or even in a rope, because God is everywhere. But even though God is everywhere, that doesn't mean he wants me to seek him just anywhere. And so throw myself on a rock, cast myself into the fire, drown myself in the water, or hang myself on a rope. God is present everywhere, but he doesn't want for you to grope in the dark for him just anywhere. Grope, rather, where the word and sacrament are found. And there you will find Jesus. There you will take hold of Jesus in the right way. Luther had a way of putting things. Don't grope around in the dark for Jesus, Luther says. Grope where the word is. What a vivid way to emphasize how important it is for us as God's people to gather weekly around the word and around sacrament. Through the preaching of the word, through the giving of the sacrament, we receive God's promise that he is indeed our bread of life. So come and hear Jesus' words of life, that you are precious in God's sight, that your life does have purpose and meaning, that God does intend to do great things through you in this world. So come and receive his words of eternal life so that you might believe in Jesus, and that by believing, you too might have eternal life. Amen.
Amen.
Lord Jesus, we thank you for being our bread of life. And everything else in our life is so uncertain. You are the only thing that is certain. Your promises remain the same. You are the same yesterday, today, and forever. You are the rock on which we can build our house, the home of our life, our faith, everything. Because you can be trusted. You always keep your promises to us. And forgive us when we look elsewhere for these promises. We look elsewhere for this life, for this faith, hope, love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, all the spirituality that we look for apart from you. We can't have the fruit of the Spirit without the Spirit. We can't have life without the giver of life. Open our eyes, Father, so that you can enable us to come to Jesus. We pray these things in Jesus' powerful name.